Bibliophiles of the internet, today I'm here to share what I'm sure will be a very lengthy March wrap-up. I read a ton of great books this month, so it was really good in terms of reading, but it was another stressful month for me personally, and I had a lot going on. I still do, but I made it through, and that's what counts. I did also want to say here at the top that I recently got a new job, potentially, and it's very new territory for me, so I'm trying to adjust to all of that, and it might throw off my video-making rhythm for a second, but nothing is changing on this channel. I'm just asking for a little bit of understanding and patience. With all that said, I have plenty of books to talk about today, so let's just dive right in with the first book I finished in March, and that was Pilar, Ramirez, and the Escape from Zafa by Julian, Randall. I was mostly focusing on review copies this month, so set your expectations accordingly, but I got this ARC from Macmillan, and it recently came out on March 1st. This is a middle grade fantasy adventure story about Pilar, who is a young Afro-Latina Dominican American girl filming a documentary about how the Trujillo dictatorship affected her family, especially in regards to some of her family's disappearances. Her older sister knows a professor who actually specializes in studying the disappearances of that time, and she offers to connect Pilar with him so that she can access some more research. But when she goes into his office, she finds a folder that has the name of her missing cousin on it, and as she reaches out to look through it, Pilar finds herself magically falling into the pages. She emerges in this fantasy world known as Zafa, where the myths and legends she's always been told are very much real, and she will have to go toe-to-toe with El Cuco himself if she hopes to save her prima and make it home in one piece. Content warnings for explorations of war crimes, genocide, massacre, abduction, and trauma, some references to death and police brutality, some thematic violence, and one HP reference. This is a refreshing and dynamic opening to a series. I can't talk about this book without first talking about Pilar herself. Her voice is what holds this story together, and it is so incredibly personable and vibrant and distinct. She is a very outspoken, inquisitive young person who isn't afraid to interrogate this fantasy world as she discovers it in real time, but also her voice perfectly captures that specific rhythm of Dominican Spanglish. Word to the wise, do not look up reviews for this book because you will find tons of reviews by non-Latina people who say that Pilar's speech patterns are annoying or repetitive or they don't meet these reader standards for what Spanish is supposed to be. And that's just senseless noise. Like I said, her voice is what moves this story. There's an ease and a familiarity to it that makes you feel like you're sitting across from a friend and just catching up after a long absence. I'll get off my soapbox right now, but it's just fantastic. This author is also a non-binary Afro-Latina poet, so I think they use language in such an intentional way that really comes across. This is a super fast-paced adventure story that creates a fantasy world where young readers can grapple with the long-lasting trauma of the Trujillo dictatorship, which is relatively recent history that directly affects a lot of folks. There's something really powerful about a character like Pilar being able to confront her culture's history and her family's history in a way that's both tangible and immediate. That sense of catharsis also comes through in the way that Pilar's family and community was essentially rendered powerless by this traumatic time in history, but now she's getting a chance to dig deep and still find the literal power within herself to fight back. Where the story fell a bit short for me was in the world building. I wish we got to see even more of Zafa, and there was a lot about this story that either felt convenient or felt like nothing more than coincidence. I wanted to see Pilar and her friends grappling with some more long-lasting consequences of their actions, but overall I still really enjoy this, and there's a little hint of perhaps something sapphic between Pilar and her friend Carmen that I'm very curious to see play out. You can check out my written review down below for more thoughts, but I gave this a solid 4 stars. Then I read my arc of Kiss and Tell by Adib Khorram. This came out from Penguin Teen on March 22nd. It is a queer contemporary YA story about Hunter Drake, an openly gay member of the ultra-popular boy band known as Kiss and Tell, and unfortunately he's having a very public falling out with his ex. So he definitely finds himself in the headlines for all the wrong reasons, and his team expects him to self-correct by showing himself as this amazing queer role model for young people, but Hunter feels like he doesn't even really know what that looks like. When his label picks up on the fact that he's been flirting with Kayvon, the Iranian-American drummer for Kiss and Tell's opening act, they suggest that the two of them start to date to generate some more positive press. Content warnings for experiences of homophobia and some homophobic and sexual slurs, references to racism, descriptions of online harassment and some sexual harassment, mentions of parental death, brief mentions of fatphobia, graphic sports injury and vomit, instances of underage drinking, and some mild sexual content. Adib is one of my favorite authors. This is not a secret. I will read anything he writes, and I'm so glad that's true about myself because I love this. I'm not going to waste any time saying that this story is different from the Darius duology because that much should be obvious, but it is similar in the way that it centers that same sense of heart and thoughtfulness. I love books that embody two completely different extremes of the same spectrum. Like, on the one hand, this is a super fun, fast-paced, exciting story about a boy band on a whirlwind North American tour, but at the same time, it's also a very nuanced interrogation of what it means to be quote-unquote visibly queer in public spaces. This story is really a deep dive on the pervasive cis-heteronormativity and also whiteness of boy band culture and markets, and it makes you question how boy bands are marketed and why they're marketed towards very specific audiences. Generally speaking, boy bands are supposed to appeal to younger audiences, cishet audiences, and that creates a very strange space where the members are then expected to present themselves as wholesome and innocent, but they also have to be attractive and desirable enough to create this parasocial possibility of romance. They have to create this fiction where their fans can believe that they can romantically or even sexually imprint onto them. So when you have an openly queer boy bander like Hunter, how do you thread that needle and how does that change that dynamic? Those are just some of the questions this story is asking, and there's so much transparency about the microaggressions and even macroaggressions that Hunter faces as a queer boy who's constantly being reduced to a stereotype and forced into this token gay boy box. That's where a lot of tension stems from in this story, from that contradiction between Hunter having an incredible amount of power that comes with this platform, but then being very strictly controlled and not having the freedom to make his own choices. The other thing I really appreciate about this story is its honesty and how it shows that being openly queer is mostly a case of damned if you do, damned if you don't. Especially because every action and experience is extrapolated as a representation of the entire queer community at large, when it's not. Hunter's queerness is also highly contested by Kiss & Tell's fanbase because there's that pervasively incorrect assumption that queerness is not appropriate and that sexual identity is solely and inherently about the act of sex. That is so laughably wrong and reductive, and I appreciate how Adib combats that by crafting this incredibly sex-positive story about a young queer boy who gets criticized for being both too gay and not gay enough at the same time, and how he's just learning to embrace those parts of himself that are deemed imperfect. Again, you can read more of my thoughts in my written review, but I thought this was just fantastic. It puts a fun twist on the fake dating trope, it masterfully uses multimedia interstitials to build out the world and add to the social commentary, it's heartfelt, and it has great characters. I do wish we could have seen even more from Hunter's bandmates, who are much more ethnically diverse than him and who have their own experiences with being stereotyped and dealing with racism, but those experiences are not as discussed as Hunter's queerness. Intellectually, I get it, it's a reflection of how white queers believe themselves to be oppressed with a capital O, but I still wanted to see even more of those other experiences. But that is a very small note, and in the end I gave this 4.5 stars. Around the same time, I was also reading my arc of Wild and Wicked Things by Francesca May. I was sent this arc by Red Hook, which is a division of Orbit, and it recently came out on March 29th. The elevator pitch is that this story is a historical sapphic spin on Gatsby, but with witches. I'll unpack that more in a second, but it's about Annie, a young queer girl whose father recently passed away and left everything to her, so now she's having to travel to this mysterious island known as Crow Island to organize his estate. There's a lot of superstitions about this place and how it's brewing with temptation and illegal magic, most notoriously when it comes to Annie's enigmatic new neighbors who are known for throwing these elaborate, bustling parties. Moving to this new place also gives Annie a chance to reconnect with her childhood friend Bee, but when Bee gets into a confrontation with Annie's neighbor at one of these parties, Annie finds herself drawn into this world of dark and dangerous magic. Content warnings for parental death, descriptions of blood and cutting for blood magic, allusions to abortion, suicide, PTSD, night terrors, and panic attacks, descriptions of death, murder, domestic abuse, and child abuse, graphic instances of injury and violence, references to infidelity, and some instances of physical assault. This is one of those cases where I think the aesthetic and the feel of the story, along with the plot, is much stronger than the actual characters themselves, which is not inherently a bad thing, but the atmosphere and the magic are definitely the story's strongest points. Going back to the Gatsby comparison, I think it's always important to go into stories with realistic expectations, so I can tell you that this is not a Gatsby retelling, but rather it takes some base inspiration from the setup of that story and then builds itself up into something very different. The historical setting works really well for this story, especially because it's set during the Prohibition era, which has these undercurrents of temptation and seduction that work really well with the added layer of these mysterious neighbors who are queer witches. With the Gatsby setup, this story also has that added challenge of following a narrator who is inherently secondary to the action. Annie especially begins as very innocent and meek, so it's very much a slow-paced, slow-burn narrative as she becomes more and more drawn to this dark magic. It's also worth mentioning that there's a really compelling concept about queer connections containing literal power and magic in and of themselves. There's also this parallel between magic and desire in this society, because magic is forbidden by law, which only makes people want it even more, of course. And not only that, but desire is what gives magic its power, in a sense. So it becomes a question of, if our desires could create magic, would we be able to control it, or would it render us powerless? The other most compelling aspect of this story, for me personally, was the murder mystery, by which I do not mean the characters have to figure out who killed someone else, but rather they kill someone themselves, and they're trying not to get found out. Like I said, it's a very slow-moving narrative at first, but once you really get into it, and the mystery kicks in, and you learn more about the consequences of this dangerous magic, it really builds towards something intense. Like I said, I personally found the characters to be somewhat lacking, or at the very least paling in comparison to the aesthetic and the thematic concepts of the story. So for those reasons, I gave this 3.5 stars. After that, I picked up my arc of The Lesbiana's Guide to Catholic School by Sonora, Reyes. I was kindly sent this arc by the author themselves, and this book comes out on May 17th. It's a queer Latina contemporary story about Yamilet, who is of indigenous Mexican descent, and after her former ex-best friend outed her at school, she could definitely use a fresh start. Her brother Cesar is also a huge troublemaker, so when he ends up having to transfer to this upscale Catholic school, Yami decides to go with him so that she can keep an eye on him for their mother's sake. Going to a new school means that she gets to start over, and she doesn't want anyone to find out that she's queer, but it's awfully hard to pretend to be straight when the only openly queer girl at her new school happens to be incredibly kind and cute. Content warnings for some descriptions of blood and mild self-harm, experiences of bullying, racism, and homophobia, references to police brutality and deportation, allusions to child abuse, instances of underage drinking, and some explorations of mental illness, suicide ideation, and hospitalization. I feel like I'm not gonna do this book justice in this limited space. It hit all the right notes for me personally, and I can confidently say that so many queer Latina people out there have been waiting for a story like this. I have to start with Yami herself, who is such an incredible narrator. I knew from the first sentence on the first page that she was gonna give everyone hell, and I was going to enjoy every single second of it. She truly does contain multitudes, because on the one hand, she's extremely independent, strong, outspoken, and even angry, but she is also scared and confused and hilariously awkward in the sense that she's fully making everything up as she goes. There's a very clear divide between the person she truly is and the person she's been forced to become just so that she can survive, and I really respect how this story honors both of those sides. Perhaps the biggest piece of commentary this story explores is the concept of being closeted and how it comes with this undue stigma of lying about yourself or not being proud enough about yourself to be authentic, which is a gross oversimplification of an extremely subjective and personal choice. This story understands that there is so much more at stake than just self-love and acceptance. Coming out as a queer person of color especially can have incredibly significant, immediate, life-altering consequences. In centering this narrative on a queer indigenous Mexican character, the story is able to really unpack some of the lesser discussed hardships that queer people of color face. There's a really strong thread about the intersection of queerness and faith, especially when so much of Mexican culture is often tied up in Catholicism, and how those beliefs can negatively impact queer youth who are desperate for that spiritual and communal acceptance. When that's part of your family, your culture, your understanding of morality, how do those messages get internalized, and what are the long-lasting consequences? All that to say that coming out for queer Latina people specifically could mean risking that excommunication from your community or your family. When those core beliefs are tied up in your family's makeup, you risk being disowned, alienated, or even subjected to violence. There's a subplot in this story about Yami having to take on the additional burden of finding part-time work and trying to make money, because in the back of her mind, she's thinking about how if her parents ever find out that she and her brother are queer, they may very well have to support themselves. You don't get to see those kinds of discussions in so many queer coming-of-age stories, and I just appreciate that realism and that honesty so much. There's also a great parallel there when it comes to Yami's experiences and her love interest Bo's experiences. Bo is a Chinese-American immigrant adopted by white parents, and she feels alienated from her own culture, and Yami is also grappling with this fear that her queerness, by definition, alienates her from her Mexicanness. That's something I've also struggled with as well, and again, it's a conversation that we don't get to see enough in queer YA books. While we're talking about Bo, another thing I really appreciate about this story is how it interrogates that privilege Bo has in being openly queer, and how she feels feels the need to be unapologetic, when in fact we should be working towards creating a world where queer people have nothing to apologize for in the first place. So there's a lot of that exploration of heaviness, struggles with self-doubt, mental health, unaccepting family, religious trauma, and so much more, but you also get to see Yami fighting tooth and nail for her own joy and for the right to express herself on her own terms. While the story does unflinchingly examine those hardships, as I said, it also has a really sweet slow burn romance between Bo and Yami, and you get to see them having those quintessential romantic high school experiences. There's also a really incredible sibling relationship between Yami and Sesar that is written so beautifully. They're so deeply connected, but also isolated from each other at the same time, and that complexity feels very realistic. I simply don't have enough space to say everything I want to say about this book. It is difficult and heartbreaking at times, but it's also funny and romantic and deeply hopeful. I highly recommend it, and I gave it 4.5 stars. After that, I read my arc of Portrait of a Thief by Grace D. Lee. I was sent this arc courtesy of Tiny Reparations Books, which I believe is a division of Penguin. It's coming out on April 5th, and it's been coined as a heist led by an all-Asian cast. It all begins with Will Chen, a Chinese-American student, senior at Harvard, studying art history, who is approached by this shadowy Chinese corporation who propositions him to raid Western museums and steal back priceless Chinese art. With $50 million on the line and the chance to make history, Will begins to assemble his team of fellow Ivy League students and dropouts to help him pull off this impossible heist. All of these collaborators have a very complicated personal history with China, but they find they can't refuse Will's offer, even if getting caught would mean losing every scrap of success they've worked all their lives to achieve. Content warnings for some instances of experienced racism and xenophobia, as well as some exploration of cancer, parental death, and grief. I was very highly anticipating this story, and I think it accomplishes so much. This is definitely a heist story, but I think it would be a mistake to go into this thinking it's going to maintain that high level of action, intrigue, and suspense that, like, a crime thriller would, when it's really not trying to be that. Let me be perfectly clear, it definitely has those elements when they're called for, but it's more so about exploring diaspora, the effects of colonialism, and what these characters are willing to risk in order to achieve greatness. What really endeared me to these characters is how approachable they seem. Even though they have these very specific skills and prestige, at the end of the day, they're still just college students who have absolutely no criminal experience. A lot of heist stories require a suspension of disbelief, and this story does to some extent as well, but I appreciate how these characters don't know everything, and they're not made out to be these superhuman experts. They start planning these jobs by talking on Zoom and taking notes on heist movies and dumping ideas and leads into a Google Doc. They're not criminal masterminds, they're just trying to make the most of the resources they can access. And that inexperience definitely carries over to other aspects of the story, so even when these characters are attempting these near impossible feats, that greenness, that inelegance, brings a sense of balance. I also really appreciate the complex dynamics within this group. Two of them are siblings, some have dated each other before, some know each other from childhood, and others are complete strangers. There's no established baseline of trust between them, and even though Will knows all of them, that doesn't mean the trust they have in him extends to the other people in the group, and that's definitely a source of tension. As you might guess, a heist has to be executed perfectly with absolutely no margin for error, and this group cannot guarantee that because they don't know for sure whether everyone is going to do their part as planned, and in fact, they often don't. So that tension, that complexity definitely keeps you guessing, but of course the major highlight of the story is the way it promises to contend with colonialism in relation to art, and how historically artwork has been prized as a trophy of conquest. I respect how the story grapples with that complicated history, but also how the reclamation of this artwork really ties into the characters' experiences of diaspora, which are all very different. Many of them rationalize these thefts as an act of reclamation, and they tell themselves that returning these pieces to their country of origin is the right thing to do. But for all of them, there's so much more at stake. There's a deeper layer of motivation for all of them, which is that they long for a concrete connection to China within their own right. As children of diaspora, they feel removed from China emotionally, socially, culturally, and they're desperate to be tied to their ancestral homeland in a way that can be observed, quantified, and uncontested. In that sense, the story makes a powerful statement about what it means to lay claim to your culture and your heritage when it's always been denied to you for surface-level reasons. A lot of that is also tied up in this pursuit of the American dream and the pressures of being expected to perform as model minorities. These characters have been conditioned to never fail no matter the circumstances and to risk everything for success. thematically, there's a lot going on under the surface, and I think that's what makes this story so compelling. With that said, I do wish we could have seen some more of the characters' families and backstories, and there were also some aspects of privilege and convenience that I don't think were properly addressed. Again, you can read my review for even more of my thoughts, but overall, I found this to be an ambitious and thought-provoking story, and I gave it 4 stars. Then, again on a whim, I picked up Zombierella, written by Joseph Coelho, illustrated by Freya Hartas, and it's the first book in the Fairy Tales Gone Bad series. This is a children's book. It's a super fun and darkly whimsical spin on the fairy tale of Cinderella, written in verse, where Cinderella actually dies before she gets a chance to go to the ball and dance with her prince. So she's visited not by a fairy godmother, but by a specter of death who resurrects her so that she can attend these 3 nights of festivities at the castle and exact revenge on her cruel stepsisters. But there's another twist in that the prince of her dreams isn't a human, he's actually a vampire prince. Content warnings for some explorations of abusive parents, instances of animal death and parental death, as well as some mild gore, body horror, and violence for thematic purposes. I'm gonna keep this brief because it's a super short, easy to read book for early readers, but I have to give a shout out to my friend Jude for bringing this author's work to Reading Hour and recommending this series. I really enjoyed this. This is definitely a fresh new take on the story of Cinderella with a super creepy twist, and I think it really strikes that sweet spot of referencing the original story enough to feel familiar, but also being innovative enough to feel original as it takes the story to new places. The verse is really fun and eccentric, and the incredible illustrations really add to the atmosphere of the story and bring it to life. No pun intended. I also appreciate how this story actually affords Cinderella's family a chance at redemption, and I think the twist of having a vampire prince is also really fun because he doesn't fall for Cinderella because of her beauty or her dress, but because she makes him feel alive. So it's really a story about second chances and making your way to your happy ending no matter what. I thought it was eerily delightful. I would definitely read more in this series, and I gave it 4 stars. On a very different note, after that I finally got a chance to read my arc of Hell Followed With Us by Andrew Joseph White. This arc was sent to me by Peachtree Teen, and it comes out on June 7th, so still a little ways away, but it's a post-apocalyptic, dystopic horror story about a trans boy named Benji who is desperately trying to escape this religious extremist cult. This cult is basically the reason why the world has ended, because they vigorously believe that their faith is telling them to purge the world of corrupted humans and start over again. So they've created this virus known as the Flood, which kills off people they call non-believers. A select few can survive the Flood and transform into monsters known as Graces, which can then be controlled to kill off any other survivors. And through experimentation, they've developed another serum that can violently transform someone into a Seraph, which can then control the Graces. Benji is a Seraph, created with the intention of wiping out the remainder of the human race. So he's violently metamorphosing, and he does not want the cult to have access to this power. So he runs away, and he's rescued by a group of queer teens from the local LGBTQ center. They take him in and offer him safety and acceptance, but if he wants to stay with them, he will have to make sure that none of them find out his secret, while he also tries to plan a way to return to the cult and destroy it from the inside. Content warnings for explorations of parental death and grief, instances of graphic death, body horror, and violence, descriptions of vomit, in-depth explorations of religious extremism, trauma, and some abuse, discussions of genocide, instances of homophobia, transphobia, misgendering, and dead naming, and some fade-to-black sexual content. I also wanted to note that Benji starts falling for this sharpshooter named Nick, who is queer and autistic. There's also characters of color, a Muslim character, and a bunch of different characters of all different identities in terms of sexuality and gender in this little found family of queer teens. This is another case of I have too many good things to say, and there is no possible way they're gonna fit in this space. It's just not gonna happen. You may recall that the first time I heard about this book was in my interview with H.E. Edgeman, and as soon as he said what it was about, I immediately added it to my list. H.E. Edgeman was not wrong, they could never be wrong, and I am gonna say, if you love The Witch King, as you should, that story definitely complements this one, and I also think fans of Surrender Your Sons would also really enjoy this. Let me backtrack a little bit and just say that this is the absolutely brutal, violent, horrific story of my dreams, which seems like a strange thing to say, but this story was just an instant shot of catharsis directly into my veins. This iteration of the world Andrew Joseph White has created is just merciless and vicious in every imaginable way, and the centering of this young trans boy and his queer found family as they're just fighting to survive with everything they have is incredibly powerful. This story hits the ground running and just does not let up for a single second. There is not a single moment in this book where Benji is not in danger, and that constant feeling of unease and fear is such a powerful insight to what many trans people experience. Even the fact that Benji is the hero of this story makes a lot of sense. The sad reality is that he has never known a world without danger. He has always been fighting to exist. He has always been surviving people in circumstances that are fundamentally unsafe. So of course, he's perfectly equipped to navigate this world. There's also a really fascinating parallel between the concept of medically transitioning and Benji slowly metamorphosing into a monster as the result of this human experimentation. With both of those situations, there's a lot of unknowns. When you take hormones, for example, there's really no knowing what exactly is going on in your body at all times, and there's no way of being able to predict the outcome because it's highly specific. And that definitely translates to the Seraph transformation because Benji never knows what change is coming next. There's also a really brilliant connection between the Seraph transformation and the experience of dysphoria, and how both of those things make Benji feel disconnected from his own body in a way that's very disorienting, and how both sensations make him feel powerless at times. And there's even a parallel to being closeted with the fact that Benji is trying to hide his Seraph because he's afraid that his friends will reject him because of his association with the cult. And as the story goes on, he's learning that he doesn't have to be afraid of that monster, that ugliness, that violence. That, to me, is the most powerful part of this story, the fact that in a world where transness and any kind of difference is weaponized against those who experience it, it is incredible to see a character who's been affected by that turn back around and become the weapon itself. Something I think about a lot is how transphobia and hate gets internalized into messages that we carry with us all the time, whether we know it or not, and how we take those words, ideas, or thoughts and wield them as weapons against ourselves. As trans people, we have to remember to put down those weapons, and I love that this story goes a step further and is like, what if Benji doesn't stop at just pointing those weapons away from himself, but then uses them to destroy the very people who hurt him in the first place? I love that Benji is this super messy, complicated character who makes mistakes and is deeply, deeply imperfect because he is very much a product of this imperfect world. How else could he possibly be? Is it healthy to want to destroy people? No. Is it satisfying to get to see a trans character actually act on their rage and anger and frustration with the world? Yes. It is just such a powerfully cathartic journey from powerlessness to agency and strength, from isolation to community, from fearing the world to becoming the thing that people fear. And I freaking loved it. I am barely scratching the surface with everything I've said here, but I cannot recommend this book enough. Please, please, please put it on your radars. I gave this a huge 5 stars. Then one of my most anticipated pre-orders came out, and even though I wasn't planning on it, I couldn't not read it. So I picked up So This Is Ever After by F.T. Lukens. F.T. Lukens is the author of In Deeper Waters, one of my favorite books of 2021. Just to be perfectly clear, while this story may very well be set in the same fantasy world in a broad sense, it is not connected to In Deeper Waters. It is not a companion book. It is not part of a series. This book is a satirical queer YA fantasy that takes place after the Chosen One has successfully completed his world-saving quest. Arik is our hero, and he just spent the last year adhering to a prophecy and questing with his friends as they tried to free a kingdom from a violent usurper's rule. And now that they've done that, they realize that they never made a plan for who would take this evil ruler's place. This kingdom needs a new monarch, and fast. So Arik decides to temporarily make himself king while they find someone else more worthy, but the second he puts on the crown, he is magically bonded to the throne. Turns out there's a magical law mandating that anyone who sits on the throne has to be soul bonded to another person before their 18th birthday or else they will perish, and that's like a safety protocol apparently to maintain balance. So now Arik is begrudgingly having to search for a soulmate, and he figures that the smartest thing to do would be to sneakily court his closest friends, but totally not because he has a not-so-secret crush on his mage and best friend, Matt. Content warnings for death, violence, mentions of blood and vomit, some descriptions of injury and drunkenness, as well as some exploration of PTSD responses. F.T. Lukens has quickly become one of my favorite authors. Their brand of fantasy is absolutely my jam, and reading their work truly brings me so much fulfillment and happiness. The entire conceit of this story is truly unique because, like I said, it's about what happens after the epic quest concludes, and it really reckons with the consequences of taking over a kingdom and everything that possibly entails. The tagline that kept coming back to me as I read this book was high fantasy, low stakes, which is a descriptor I've heard attributed to other stories, but it's the perfect tagline for this book as well, because the entire thing is just romantic shenanigans. That's not to say that nothing is at stake, because obviously Arik's life is very much hanging in the balance, and he and his friends are definitely struggling to regain a sense of normalcy after risking their lives for so long, but they're still relatively low stakes, and it's nice. This might seem silly to say because as a fantasy novel, this story isn't exactly rooted in realism, but what I love about it is that it realistically addresses how even though unseating a vile ruler is heroic, it's also an inherently political act. Removing a monarch means establishing a new one, and you have to create a council, understand the laws and etiquette, learn how the palace operates, strengthen relations with other kingdoms, regain the trust of the populace, offer reparations, and so much more. It's weird, it's awkward, not everyone's gonna be on board, there's no handbook for how to rule a kingdom, and the story almost glories in those growing pains and that uncertainty as the characters try their best to get back on their feet. I just love the self-awareness at the heart of this story. The characters understand how just because you follow a prophecy doesn't mean that everything is going to turn out perfect, and they really have to learn to lead with their strengths and not their weaknesses or self-doubts. I think that's what hit my heart the most about this story, the fact that Arik and his friends are really having to realize that they are enough. There hasn't been some horrible mistake. They're not acting as placeholders until someone stronger, better, smarter, more worthy, or more experienced comes to claim the crown. They're it. And they've always been enough to do this. There's also a really great thread about the importance of agency, especially with this group coming off a quest foretold by a prophecy. They feel like they didn't have much of a choice but to follow that prophecy, and now that it's behind them, Arik really wants to protect everyone's right to choose. He doesn't want any of his friends to feel obligated to bond themselves to him for his own sake. He wants them to choose their own path, and he recognizes how precious that choice really is. But while that's definitely endearing, he also has to learn that these people he loves are, in fact, choosing him back. I have absolutely nothing bad to say about this. It's hilarious, it's bursting at the seams with romantic tropes, it's a refreshing take on the hero's journey, it has an incredible cast of queer characters who embody classic fantasy archetypes, and it's a fairy tale where the Arthurian-esque king gets to be in love with his mage. It is arguably perfect. I love this soft, silly book, I love F.T. Lukens, and I gave this 5 stars. Because of work stuff, I am filming this early, so I may or may not have read something else by the time you watch this, but I have nothing else to give at this point, and anything else I read will be reviewed somewhere, someway, somehow. Again, I have been taking part in Pondathon, which has been super fun. This version of my terrarium may not be perfectly up to date because I'm still waiting on some rewards, but I've been doing some rearranging, and I think it looks pretty nice. You know the drill. If you've read any of these books yourself, or if you plan to, feel free to stop by the comments down below and let me know what you think. But that's everything I had to share for today. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.